And it's given me the opportunity to reach out and help a number of different organizations within the Chambers of Commerce and universities and other organizations to try and get them to understand how to use media. So this is not about my radio station, this is not about my company. This is about helping you use media more effectively. So we're going to talk about how to leverage media metrics in order to grow the line of your business. Okay? So the first thing we have to talk about when we talk about leveraging media metrics is what it's like to be a consumer, right? And there are four steps to the consumer journey as it's defined. So the first thing you want to do is you want to attract people to your business, right? You want to let them know that you're here. But that's not enough to get the right product. The next thing you have to do is you have to find some way to come to the media, whether it's visiting your website, coming to your store, calling you on the phone, whatever it is, meeting and engage with you, or start that community, heading down the path of the material. Then the next step in the process is to work to make them a customer of yours. And once they're a customer of yours, fingers crossed, they become an advocate for your business. And what we're going to focus on today, very specifically, is we're going to focus on the concept of conversion. Getting somebody who is heard about your business and converting them into a client. Make no mistake, this is the only way. Getting them to be an advocate. I shop at Bob's for the tires, and then I call my best friend who's looking for tires. We got to go to Bob's. Right? So it's great, whatever it is. So that's when you've really done your job as a business. You've gotten people to come and shop with you and then talk about it. We've all heard the phrase word of mouth. That's what this is. Right? So, let's see what it does. Okay. So we measure advertising by the question how many people we want to reach and how many times we want to reach them. And it doesn't matter how we do it. Whether you do it on the radio or television or obviously on the main billboards or you've got guys standing on the street and asking how the sign is there. That's all marketing. And a lot of words down there. How many people are going to get this message? And how many times they're going to get it? And what we want to do is we want to measure the concept of how many people get this message. And we get specific metrics.
With this high bar, 30 yellow boy, we're going to try to blast open this master lock model number 15. We blew our half inch hole clear through. But the master lock still holds tight. If you want to hold on to what you've got, insist on genuine master locks, known for being tough under fire.
Anyone other than me see this fellow being a Russian? By the way, this is a question for you. Okay, there he is. Good.
I think I've been there.
Okay, this was a very famous television. And it's famous not particularly controversial. It's famous for how it was broadcast. So let me tell you a little about the commercial. It's 30 seconds in length, and it aired at grand total of 21 times, once every year, 1973 to 1994. And guess this is where they aired it? In the Super Bowl. Every single year for 21 years. The only reason they stopped is because we haven't pressed the Super Bowl ad lately, they're $2.5 million for 30 seconds. So they stopped at some point when the cost became prohibitive for them to participate. So, it was 100% of their advertising budget. Tens of millions of people saw this commercial, but they all saw it once a year. And how effective is this? Maybe another luck company. This is decades after they stopped advertising, and it still works. And by the way, if you go and buy a master lock, it still says under fire. So what you want to do is you want to figure out how to use either a reach or a frequency of message to grow your business. So the first thing you need to understand is that media is like a 7-11. So how many people pass through the 7-11 on any given day? Anybody have a guess? Actually, Rest of the movie. The average 7-Eleven sees about 600 people a day, which is fascinating. When you go to a 7-Eleven, how many people are there with you? Like 3 to 4 people, right? So 600 people pass through the 7-Eleven, 2 or 3 at a time. And we're going to use the idea of the 7-Eleven as we talk about reaching towards the advertising, because if you go to a 7-Eleven on a regular basis, if you go at the same time, you see the same people. And if you go throughout the day, you see a whole bunch of different people, which is really interesting because that's exactly how media works. So, let me give you an example of what's best for your business. As we walk through the process of the consumer journey, your business is either going to have niche-based advertising or frequency-based advertising. And we're going to measure by how many people get the message and how many times they get the message. And for years and years and years, it's been this ongoing myth. If somebody has to hear your announcement or hear about your business 3 times in order for them to actually get the message, that is 100% a lie. It's never been true. There are some customers that heard your message once and flocked to your business, and there are some people that have heard your message 1,000 times and have not yet come. And this is why this is. Okay, can you check me out? You're kind of excited. You love country music? If you found out that Kenny Chesney was appearing in the Blaze Dev Center in October, you heard this on the radio or saw this on television. How many times would you need to hear that before you bought a ticket? Exactly. These are opt-in, opt-out decisions. You either want to go see Kenny Chesney or you don't. If you do, the minute you hear the commercial, you're going to buy a ticket. If you don't, no matter how many times I invite you, you're not going to buy a ticket. So let me tell you how this works. It's all based on the first time somebody hears the message, your decision is immediate and immutable. I cannot change your mind. No disrespect intended on not being a family. Let me tell you, you told me 1,000 times in Jesus' name. I'm not going to see it. Probably not going to see it from the West side. But let me tell you a story from my life. This is absolutely true consumer journey story. So my wife, myself, my best friend, and his wife are all together. We were talking about concerts that we've seen in bands that we've never seen before, either they're dead or they're dead. And the topic comes up of the Royal Orchestra. And I said, can I saw them when I was a kid? And so had my buddy's wife, Rachel. We were probably at the same show, even though we knew each other, we didn't go to the show together. But she was probably at the same show I was at the Forum in Los Angeles. Neither my wife nor Steve, the writer, had seen the record by Rachel. I was like, man, just one time I'd like to go back and see it. So I get the car next to me, I'm driving to the office, and they announced the summer lineup for the Holy Moon. And lo and behold, well, I did play other business, playing some lineup at Holy Moon. I bought tickets that morning. It was the first thing I did when I got to the office. I didn't check my email. I didn't check my voicemail. I went immediately to Ticketmaster.com and bought 4 tickets. Not even going with my friends who were there. Because I knew they would change their plans to go see the And what that tells you is that it wasn't necessary to reach me 3 or 5 or 7 or 10 times to get me to act. You got me from attraction to engagement to conversion instantly. And then when I had won the tickets to get Master of the Lottery, right? I called my buddy and I said, you are not going to do this. I just got 4 tickets. Here's the date. Cancel whatever you're doing. We're going to see it. It was that simple, right? And so what you want to focus on when you're advertising for reach is the way you say it in your commercials. So here's how it looks on paper. What you want is random commercial scheduling. As broad a day part as possible in as many different times as possible. Because if you think about it from a 7-11 perspective, if you go every morning at 7:15, the same guys that are running his donut and coffee, you don't want to talk to him more than once. You want to say, I'm the CEO? Yes or no? Yes? Great, I'm done with you. You want to be CEO? Yes, great, I'm done with you. Go around the room and ask everybody in the room. Because you've got to talk to 50, 60, 70,000 people to put 20,000 people in the Hollywood Bowl. And that's true of any stadium, any event, any anything, right? So, here's how we look at reach advertising. If something is available for a limited time, write down the speakers at McDonald's. Anybody here make a rib sandwich? I'm so sorry. It's, there's a YouTube video on how to make it. Watch it. Never be angry. Anyway, the important part of the story is, by the way, we love McDonald's there. What's important about this is anytime there's something available for a limited time, you want to talk to as many people as possible and say, this is here. By the way, there are a handful of people sitting at home right now waiting for the return of the regular sandwich from McDonald's, just like they wait every year for the return of Kluwer pork to Taco Bell and all of those other things that happen seasonally. They can't wait. And so all you have to tell them is bad. You only have to tell them once. And they'll be in the drive-thru and be picking up their report and shooting up whatever they're saying to talk about, right? It's also something you have to be limited appeal. So if you need to talk to 1 million people to find the 10 or 15 people that are really going to do this, either because it's super expensive or it's really weird, right? You need to talk to a lot of people to find those people that are interested. Also, something has a very short sales cycle. If the decision is instant, to buy it or not. You want to say, can you just be yes, I'm in, I'm buying, I'm done. You're going to have to ask again. And then finally, you judge it by the phrase, is this decision an opt-in or opt-out decision? Does it happen immediately when you hear the message? So here are the things that expand reach. Broaden the day part of such advertising. Advertising warnings at out. Middays, add evenings, add weekends, add anything that will expand the number of people that are touched by the message. If you're buying the radio and you're buying the country station, buy the pop station, buy the stations where they don't listen to each other. And then finally, add a medium. If you're buying radio, add television. If you're buying television, add digital. If you're buying digital, add something else. Just keep adding and adding and adding. Different places to reach people because different people will be reached by that. And that's the message that you want to give, right? How many people can I talk to as few times as possible? Because once they hear the message, they're going to say yes or no instantly. Do I receive Disney on Ice? My kids are 30. I'm done with Disney on Ice. So they have grandkids. So you're going to need to talk to me for maybe another 5 or 6 years. Then I'm in, right? That's all this is. So now let's talk about frequency advertising. Frequency advertising runs a little different way. And for ladies in the room, when was the last time you changed your behavior investment? Years, right? She had to move away and go back to the neighborhood or whatever, right? This is when you change your records, okay? When you walk out of the joint and she's destroyed your hair. So the important part of frequency message is it's a moment of need decision. It's based on when you have need for the product. You can hear the message. There's a brand new hairstylist who just moved here from New York, the most famous hairstylist in the world. You're not leaving until your hairstyle is about something to you, you know, and then you go see the one that just arrived in town. So that message has to be recent and consistent in order to develop results. And here's what that looks like in real life. So I was a Verizon customer, and by the way, no disrespect to Verizon, this is not about that. I was a Verizon customer for years and years and years and years and years. And then one day I came home from work, and my wife greeted me at the door with the Verizon bill. And it was $1 billion. I mean, it was so large, I couldn't even believe it. Like, there has to be a mistake. This is God. Let's call them because this just can't happen. So we get on the phone with Verizon and we find out we used our data. Remember when they had data limits and things, right? Back in the day, if you overused your data limit, they charged you a fortune for every byte of information. Well, let me tell you, my son had recently gotten a new job. He was the gamekeeper of the golf course, which means he was driving around on a tractor all day, mowing the lawn. It's a lot of lawn. So 8 hours a day, 6 days a week, he's streaming audio on his phone, and we've used $1 billion worth of data. So after negotiating with Verizon to get out of the $1,000 bill, I was in the car, went into the office, and I heard an ad for T-Mobile, and the ad said, T-Mobile doesn't charge for audio streaming. Stream all the music you want, it doesn't touch your data limit. We were T-Mobile customers that night. I took the entire family to jail with all our gear, we got all the gear, and I'm still a T-Mobile customer today. And by the way, this is not any worse for T-Mobile. It's just that commercial gear and my mind of need, which is critical. Because if it doesn't hear my need, and by the way, I heard that commercial 100 times and did nothing with it. Because I had no need for it. My Verizon service was really fine. My bills were long. It was the same every month. I was happy until I wasn't. And then when I wasn't happy, it was because it was multiple thousands of dollars to allow my son to stream audio while we were just trying to run down the office. And that's why we changed. So here's what frequency advertising is. What you want to do is run your commercial in a serialized fashion at the same times every day. If you walk in the 7-Eleven at the same time every day, you'll see the same guidelines off your head. And you want to ask me, how's your cell phone carrier doing for you? Can you get a new cell phone service? And if he says no, you say, no worries, I'll check with you tomorrow. And you check with him tomorrow, for month after month, until he says, oh my God, my son is running my bill to $4,000. I need a new cell phone service. You know? And by the way, that's true with every professional service. Doctors, lawyers, chiropractors, heating and air conditioning repair people, audio distributors, anybody that provides a professional service, you want to market your business through frequency of message. You want to be recent and consistent. And I'll tell you one other very brief story. There's an attorney in Los Angeles his name is Sweet James Berger. That's exactly how he goes on the air, Sweet James. And his website is sweetjames.com. He is an accident attorney, a personal injury attorney. And every morning for 5 years when I was in Los Angeles, I heard his commercial. Every single morning. And realistically, I also heard it a couple other times throughout the day as I was, you know, skimming in and out of my favorite radio station. Realistically, I heard the commercial 5,000 times. And for his business, Sweet James is sitting behind his desk right now, going, God, it looks like it's a bad truck today. Preferably a Walmart truck, because Walmart has one. Right? And he's going to go out to Walmart. I heard that commercial for 5,000 times. And Sweet James has absolutely no idea what the word comes from. Because I never got any answer. I never had any reason to call. But it was so effective I've been off the mainland for over a year. And CJ's telephone number is 1-800-500-5200. I still remember his phone number today. So if I would go back to the mainland and get in an accident in California and call CJ, I don't even know what he's going to try. I just know that I know his phone number. And that's what you want to be for your consumers, is recent and consistent, so that when a moment need arises, they call you instead of your competitor, or they can see your business instead of your competitor's business. So here's how you do that. You do it based on whether or not your product is always available, if it's a mass appeal product, if the sales cycle is long. Sweet sales cycle with me was 5 years, and he still wouldn't close the deal because I had no reason to call. I had no need for his services, right? And if the decision is based on what you need. So if you have to wait for something to act on somebody, a force to change their living situation in order to come see you, you need to advertise for you. And again, it doesn't matter where you do it or how you do it. You just need to be very recent and very consistent. So here's how to make it work. You want to narrow the amount of time that your commercials air. If you're running in mornings, stay in mornings. If you want to keep this organized, people's lives are really static. People's habits are static person to person, right? Every person has their own habits. So if I get up every morning at 5 o'clock and I go straight to the gym, if you run a commercial at 5:15 in the morning, you're going to touch me on my drive to the gym. That's all you want. Hey, did you get into an accident today? No. If you're going to add a radio station, or if you're going to add a television station, stick to programs that are identical, right? Don't buy a soap opera on one station and a football game on the other station. Buy all sports. Or buy all soap operas. Or buy all talk shows. So that you get the same people. Because the same people who watch Ellen also watch Steve Harvey, right? And then finally, the longer you run the schedule, the more successful it is. Period. Don't stop after 3 weeks or 6 weeks or 8 weeks. Try for 15 or 20 or 30 weeks. Don't stop. Because the minute you stop, your competitor takes your place in the mind of the consumer. And you do not want that. You want to be the most recent and the most consistent message to that potential consumer. So, here are some ways to choose whether or not you should use reach or frequency. First of all, the product that you have. Is the product that you have a limited need product, or is it a product that's available for such a limited time that you just want to ask yes or no if you want this? Because if I say no, I don't even have time to change your mind. I'm done with you all going to the next customer, right? We want to talk about the budget that you have. And even though I don't like to make budget a theme, if you have an enormous amount of money to spend, you're better off spending it on frequency of message over time than you are on buying a 3 or 4 week schedule just to get as much reach as you can. But if your budget is limited, like Master Lock, sometimes it's better to just run one really big ad and be done with it. And then obviously, the store that you have, the environment of the store really matters. You're not sure what's on your business. If your business is going to allow you that for 25 years, reach is important. You need to focus on frequency of message. Remember, we will never get better. If you're a brand new business, reach is the most important thing you can do. I know here, come see me. You want to pay attention to the sales cycle over the short long. Short sales cycles are generally reach oriented, long sales cycles are generally frequency oriented. And the other thing you want to pay attention to is the economy. And by the way, I apologize for looking backwards. Laptop should be sitting up here. We have a very short cord, so I'm going to go over my shoulder and I'm going to make sure I've got editors in my screen. The economy is really important. And the running joke is talking to a guy with $5 in his pocket 10 times is not talking to $50, right? You need to talk to 10 guys with $5 in their pocket. That's $50. So in an economy that has been damaged The more people you can talk to, the more likely you are to get customers. Because some people who've been to your business once or twice in the last year might not be able to come back at all. Some who were there 3 or 4 times might only come once. So to achieve historical sales performance levels, you're going to have to talk to way more people in order to get enough back in your store to make you successful. Does that make sense? Cool. All right, so let's talk about social media, because everyone wants to talk about social media. It's one of the things I get asked a million times. I run all my stuff on social media, and it's working. And there's nothing wrong with that, by the way. Social media is really effective. But what you want to pay attention to in social media is it's not the media part of social media that matters. It's the social part. Let me explain. So, this is an ad for a friend of mine's pastry shop. He quit his job as a CPA after 30 years and decided he wanted to become a baker. And so he opened up a pastry shop and started making cookies. And by the way, his cookies are really good. And that's an ad on Facebook that he posted. And it's a good looking ad. The problem is, it's an ad on Facebook. And what happens to those ads on Facebook? We scroll right past it. So, here's another post on Facebook. This is the highway. Now, the picture is not nearly as nice as the photo of the pastry shop. But there's one big difference. My son posted that picture for a bunch of his friends. And you can see the quote. Jason Mednick's recommended this place. Very good. By the way, the food on the highway is amazing. It doesn't look good, but it's amazing, right? And probably some of those are offended Hawaiian food on the highway. It's spectacular. And as much as you don't want to see how we are going to on a photograph, it still tastes great. So this is how social media marketing works. It works based on social influence. We all have a limited amount of social influence with our friends. We've all got Instagram. We've all taken the time to post a picture of it and say, you've got to go here. It's the best sushi on earth. It's the best pizza on earth. It's the best whatever, right? And your friends have taken you up on that and they've gone and they've posted back and said, I wonder if it's awesome. Thanks so much, right? It requires social influence. So let's talk about the greatest social influencer of all time. Anybody not know who this is? Michael Jordan. Okay? Michael Jordan made $130 million from Nike last year. Exactly. $130 million from Nike last year. By the way, that's 4 times as much money as LeBron James made from Nike. And LeBron James played basketball. Michael Jordan hasn't played basketball for almost 2 decades. And he's been paid over $1 billion for Nike. And here's the great part. This is what all of the media marketing executives say about the Nike deal. They consider this to be the biggest endorsement bargain in the history of sports. They paid this man $1 billion for 20 years after he was played, and they still consider this the biggest bargain in sports marketing history. Because for every dollar they paid Michael Jordan, they brought in $100. That's social influence. Now there's one difference between you having social influence and Mike having social influence. Everybody knows that Mike's getting paid. Most people don't know how much. But everybody knows that Mike's getting paid for doing this, right? Because he wouldn't wear Nike shoes or talk about Nike products if he wasn't making money doing it. So when you want to find social influence, if you want people that are genuinely believable to use the product without necessarily the image that they're getting paid for, so let me show you what that looks like. This is a air personality in New Orleans, Louisiana. She goes on the air as Uptown Angela. And Uptown, as we call her, took a photograph of yourself sitting in your car, eating a Doritos Locos taco from Taco Bell, and look at the responses you get. You turned me on to these things. Man, these things are great. I gotta go try these things, right? I'm hoping that she wasn't driving it. She took this photograph. I'm assuming she's driving it, right? But this is amazing stuff. Here's a picture of another DJ at the age of the world. He's using a slab. You are right. And DJ Slab 1, or Slab 2, Slab stopped by Captain Seas. Now, Captain Seas made snowballs. We call them shaved ice here. But in New Orleans, they call them snowballs. And he just stopped by because Captain Seas is the place to go get snowballs. If you're the New Orleans, best snowballs in the city. And so all he did was a bunch of his buddies came there, and they figured this was a fun social media moment because lots of people were there to Captain Seas. So he posted the picture. 221 likes for a guy who did nothing but buy tables, right? He wasn't being paid for this. It's just a famous place that a lot of people go. And almost everybody who goes there takes a picture of themselves when they got to see something. Posted. The difference is when I went and took that picture, there were three guys who wanted to post my mom. When he did, 221 people liked it. That means 1,000 people saw it. That's social influence. If Slab walks into a nightclub wearing a green Adidas hat turning sideways, you go back to that same club 2 weeks ago, and the 8 guys wearing that hat. He has real social influence. This is our morning show. Set them off, and Kayla showed the point. And Kayla got donuts delivered from Purvey. If you haven't been to Purvey, amazing. They're great donuts. They really are amazing donuts. Anyway, these were delivered to the studio. He snapped a photograph, put it on his Instagram, and you can see the responses. Man, I gotta try these things. Now, this was not an endorsement. Purvey was not paying us at all. He just got Purvey donuts. Delivered to the studio and said, drop them off. So he snapped a picture on Instagram, posted it, and now people are going to go. So you need to pay attention to social media and use it this way. Don't just post a picture of your stuff because nobody cares. No disrespect. But nobody cares. Get someone to post a picture of your stuff. It's been in the community for years. It shops at your store every day. Ask them, hey, you come get my donuts every week. Would you like posting something on Facebook and tagging my Facebook page? Then we'll be connected to the people that they're connected to. And that's how you use social media. Oftentimes you have to buy the right to do that. I'm using a local influencer. Sometimes you don't. But that's how social media marketing works. So remember, when you're trying to create a commercial campaign, focus on how many people might be reached and how many times you might be reached. And if you do just that, your marketing will be infinitely more successful. If you get contacted by anyone selling anything in the realm of marketing, ask them to show you how many people they're reaching and how many times they're being reached on average. And if you get those two numbers, you can determine whether or not it's going to be enough to build your brand and your business, or if they're just trying to make money. And with that in mind, thank you very, very much for having me.